Good evening and welcome to this special session with Professor Michael Sandel. It's a great pleasure having Professor Sandel here. And we are extremely thankful that he's agreed to take his time off and be with us for an hour and a quarter today. In fact, I was quite surprised and taken aback when I first wrote a mail to him and he most readily agreed to be with us. So we are greatly honored, Professor Sandel, that you've joined us today.
Thank you for having me. Thank you so much for having me. I'm honored to be with you.
Thank you. So, Professor Sandel, we are doing this from IIMB Bangalore, and we are live on YouTube, and there are lots of people watching on YouTube, so we'll sort of get to know those numbers as we go along. But Professor Sandel doesn't need too much of an introduction. Nevertheless, it is customary, so let me sort of introduce him. He teaches political philosophy at the three of his books have been best-selling books and have been translated into seven languages. I guess not yet into Kannada, Professor Sandel, which is our language here in Karnataka, but hopefully we'll address that as well at some point in time. And he's also known for his iconic course Justice, which was put completely online and free a long time before the concept of MOOCs even came up. And as Shashi Tharoor introduced him in a recent conversation, he's a rock star professor. He's spoken to very, very large audiences, including in Seoul, where 14,000 people came to listen to him, Sydney Opera House, and St. Paul's Cathedral. He also runs a BBC series called The Global Philosopher, which explores the philosophical ideas. And hopefully, in the course of the conversation, he'll also talk about the other things that he does, you know, in one sense. Professor Sandel, it's a great pleasure. I was hoping that Professor Krishnan, who's our director, will join us to welcome you. But nevertheless, he'll join in due course, as I indicated to you. I would also like to, at this moment, thank Mr. Ramashankar Pandey, IIMB second batch, Managing Director of Hella India Lighting, for sponsoring this event on behalf of Prayas. It's an NGO focused on education, healthcare, and shelter for orphans, needy children, and underprivileged. So that's our sponsor for the day. So let me start with a very basic question, Professor Sandel. When you're talking of meritocracy, we'd like to know. So let me also sort of go through the format a little bit. About 15-20 minutes, we will discuss with faculty panel. And we have 10 of our students, 5 of first year students and 5 of second year students with us. And they have come prepared. So they will interact with Professor Sandel for another 20-25 minutes. And I have a set of questions which I've already received from people who have registered, and a few more questions will come in the way. So we will go through those questions in the last 20-25 minutes. That's broadly the format. And Professor Sandel prefers a conversational format, so he's not going to talk about the book straight away, but we'll try to extract as much of content from the book as possible as a part of the conversation. The first question, Professor Sandel, that we have is, how do you define meritocracy? Is it defined largely in academic terms? Because there is merit in sport, there is merit in other arena as well. So when you talk of the meritocracy and the tyranny of meritocracy, are you sort of restricting it to the intellectual world? I mean, that is, if you can elaborate on that, that would be useful.
Yes, well, thank you for that question. Sriram, and thank you for having me. And I'm really looking forward to this discussion. And I know that the faculty and also the students have some hard questions about the argument of my book, The Tyranny of Merit. And so I'm hoping no one will hold back so we can have a robust exchange of ideas. Now, the title of the book, in a way, is a paradox, The Tyranny of Merit. It's a paradox because we think of merit as an ideal. And just as you mentioned, Sriram, merit arises not only in assigning places in universities, but also in debates about who deserves what, who deserves the rewards that the market bestows on various jobs, who deserves places on sports teams. So I do discuss debates about merit and reward and who deserves what and why under the heading of merit. A few of the examples I give refer to great sports figures who command enormous pay and also honor and prestige. But I am mainly concerned with the role that merit and meritocracy play in debates about what makes for a just society, which means I emphasize pay, inequalities of income, inequalities of social esteem, and also who deserves admission to universities. So I think the economy and higher education are institutions that are central to debates about what's a just society. So that's my focus in the book. But I do mean merit to be a concept that comes up and is contested whenever we are trying to figure out, Sriram, who deserves what and why.
So, Michael, let me sort of press on the sports thing a little bit. You know, I guess we have our own cricket, which, you know, you might not be very familiar with. But you have your basketball, baseball, rugby, you know, whole range of these. And in the leagues, there's an auction for the players. And, you know, there also, is there a big difference between the competence of the player and the paycheck that they get? And is that something that also bothers you in sport as well? I mean, I'll come back to the academic part very soon, but I just wanted to get a sense of, because in one sense, we have all these stories of, you know, small town boys making it big in these and barriers, and that is really meritocratic. And we have also had children of very successful sports persons not being able to make it, even though they got not being able to stay there, right? So is that a, I mean, that's something that.
I don't think it's unfair. In fact, I would say it's inspiring when we hear about a cricketer, for example, a great cricket player who arises from a poor background, not from a privileged background, and manages to succeed. There's something thrilling and inspiring about this. And I think part of what we admire is the ability to rise from humble origins, from a poor background, and to take center stage to win good pay and also the adulation of the fans, whatever background one comes from. And we see this in sports all the time. So the question is this: does the inspiring character of these stories, up from poverty to play cricket, traditionally a sport of the privileged, is the fact that we find this inspiring proof that meritocracy in general is what defines a just society? I would say no, not necessarily. We can appreciate and be inspired by these stories, Sriram, even without accepting the full meritocratic ideal, which says not only that no one should be held back by poverty or caste or ethnicity, it also says that those who succeed have earned their success Our success is our own doing, and therefore the successful deserve all the rewards that the society heaps upon the successful. That's the full meritocratic ideal. It has to do not only with removing obstacles, it has also to do with the way we think about success. And it's that idea of success that I think is damaging. It has a dark side. It creates a society of winners and losers. It leads the successful to believe that their success is their own doing. It leads the successful, therefore, to forget the luck and good fortune that helped them on their way. It leads them to forget their sense of indebtedness to those who made their success possible: families, teachers, community, country, the times in which we live. So I'm very much in favor of a society that removes all barriers to achievement. That's the inspiring part of the story. But I don't think we should conclude from that, that the successful, the winners in sport or in academia or in the economy, we should not conclude that the winners have done it on their own and therefore deserve morally all the benefits that flow from winning. Does that distinction make sense, Sriram, do you think?
Yeah, I mean, my question is, you know, in a way you're framing it as winners and losers and into two buckets, right? Is that really two different buckets of winners and losers, or is it winners and people who did not win? Because, you know, in this framing, there is I get a sense that the winners sort of look down upon or are contemptuous about those who do not win, not by saying that you are losers, but by saying I am entitled because I tried hard. And that does that mean that, you know, the people who did not make it get a sense that they've lost out, or is it because they still want to strive? I mean, that's something I don't think it is so much of a black and white. I mean, that was my issue with your framing. So.
Right. Well, I agree with you to this extent that the mere fact that we have unequal outcomes, that some are great cricketers and others not so great, that others get into the top IIMs and others do not, that fact by itself does not necessarily create a society of winners and losers. I agree with you. Whether it does or not depends on the attitudes towards success, both of those who win and among those who fall short. And one of the arguments central to the tyranny of merit, to the book, is that merit becomes a kind of tyranny when we take up attitudes towards success that attribute moral desert or entitlement to the winners, and that treat those who struggle, those who are left behind, as losers. It's that set of attitudes, that way of justifying the distribution of winnings, that gives rise to the problem. And the reason I emphasize these attitudes toward success, Sriram, is that in recent decades, the divide between winners has been deepening. And this is partly to do with the widening inequalities of recent decades. But it's not only that. It's also to do with the changing attitudes toward success that have accompanied the widening inequalities. Here's a way to think about it. Do we want a society? Should we aim for a society that brings everyone up to the same starting point in the race and then says, let the race begin? The race is fair. And if the race is fair, the winners deserve their winnings, and those who are not among the top finishers deserve some lesser rewards. Is that an image of a just society? And I suggest that it isn't, for two reasons. First, even if everyone truly started at the same starting point in the race, some have had a lot of training, some have had good coaches, some have very good running shoes, some have had a special diet perhaps, whereas others have lacked these advantages, even though they start the race at the same starting point. But there's a second objection to this vision of a just society. And it's this: even if everyone had the same good coaches and the same practice facilities and the same equipment, the same running shoes and diet, even then, there would be a lot of luck in who finished first, in who won the race. One, even if they all strived equally hard and trained equally hard, who would win? The most gifted runners, the fastest runners. But is it our doing? Is it my doing that I happen to be gifted in ways that enable me to run a race? Or is that my good luck? That's the question that I want to put to meritocracy, even one where everyone starts from the same starting point of the race, Sriram.
Yeah, but I mean, that is bound to happen. So in a way, is there a way that we could address this? We are born unjust in one sense. If somebody is gifted, you're born unjust. You're born sort of more equal than the others. So in that sense, how do we address that? I mean, I don't think we'll be able to address that. As a society, we may be able to get everyone on a same starting line, but beyond that, the point that you're making is achievers should have humility. Is that broadly what you're hinting at?
Yes, achievers should have humility, and that humility should lead them and should lead the wider society to assume that the winnings are not theirs alone. But since the winners are indebted to luck, to their gifts, and to the society that enabled them to develop those gifts, if that's all true, not only should the winners have an attitude of humility toward their success, they should accept and embrace the idea that those winnings are not really theirs alone, but should be shared with the wider society, including those who are not gifted runners. So while it's true enough that we are born with different capacities and gifts and talents, that by itself is not an injustice. It's only an injustice if we create a society that enables those who were born lucky to enjoy all of the winnings, claim the winnings as their own, without any sense of obligation to share those winnings with the wider society that made them possible. That's what I'm suggesting. So here's another way of answering your question: what to do about the fact that some people are more talented, more gifted than others? There are really two possible ways of dealing with it. One is suggested in a dystopian story by the writer Kurt Vonnegut. It's a story called Harrison Bergeron, and it imagines a totalitarian society that wants everything to be equal. But because some people are more gifted, more intelligent, more handsome, better athletes, better dancers than others, Vonnegut imagines that in this dystopia, the equality is achieved by imposing handicaps so that fast runners would have to wear lead shoes and beautiful actors or dancers would have to wear disguises to disguise their good looks. And people who were intellectually gifted would have to wear some kind of, well, AirPod or something that would send radio waves to interfere with their thoughts every so often so that they wouldn't exceed the intellectual achievement of others. This is the dystopian way. And he's suggesting, I think, that any commitment to equality beyond an equal starting point eventually requires equipping fast runners with lead shoes. That would be one way of dealing with it. That's not my way, nor do I think it's the only way. The other way of dealing with natural differences of talents and gifts is in the way I was suggesting earlier, to consider not to prevent the fast runners from running fast, but to have a general social understanding that in virtue of luck and gift and contingency and indebtedness, the winnings are not only theirs. That's what I see as the alternative, the way of dealing with the natural differences that all of us bring to life.
I have lots more of questions, but I think Rishi has joined in. I'd like to bring Rishi in and please take over and ask your question. In fact, one of the things that I'll just leave this and, you know, because I can't. Right. Professor Sandel, the taxation is all about redistribution, isn't it? I mean, if we have a good taxation and an inheritance framework, does it not address this? I'll just park that and I'll get Rishi in. I don't want to talk the Rishi, you could come in.
Thank you, Sriram. Sorry, Professor Sandel, that I got a little delayed. So my apologies to you. I was just thinking when I heard you just now that it sounded a little bit as though you are advocating a kind of socialist solution. I wasn't very sure whether your ideal world could really coexist with a capitalist economic model. Do you have any comments on that?
I think that the idea that the winnings of the successful in a society are not theirs and theirs alone. Some socialist thinkers begin with this idea to argue for redistribution, but it's also possible for people who support a capitalist organization of the economy to favor, just as Sriram was suggesting, a tax system, a progressive tax system, that taxes the wealthy or those with high incomes at a rate higher than the tax rate for the poor, and that creates a welfare state and a safety net and some redistributive policies. So I think this general idea, this way of thinking about whether or not the successful morally deserve the full measure of the rewards the market bestows on their talents, this way of thinking is compatible with, in principle, compatible with redistributive taxation within a capitalist framework, or with the kind of redistribution and sharing associated with various socialist or social democratic frameworks. I don't think it's necessarily supports one or the other.
Yeah, thank you. If I can just move on to a slightly different question. Towards the end of the book, you talk a lot about the importance of recognizing work and the importance of maintaining its dignity. And you know, in a country like India, we have the huge challenge of trying to find jobs and employment for millions of people. So often policymakers come up with proposals like giving out cash subsidies in the form of what they call a universal basic income these days. What's your view on this? And you know, how does this sort of relate to the whole tyranny of merit argument?
I'm ambivalent about the universal basic income for the following reason. I like the fact, especially if it's generous enough, that a universal basic income can provide a basic living and perhaps more for everyone, regardless of whether they're able to get a job given the shape of the economy. So that's a good thing, provided it can be funded without destroying or undermining funding for public services and for healthcare and for other necessary public expenditures. If there's a way of raising funding it without destroying public services and healthcare and education, then it has a lot to be said for it. But the reason I'm ambivalent is I think it's important not to consider a universal basic income as an alternative to initiatives to provide work for everyone. It should not let policymakers off the hook for providing policies that make jobs at decent pay, jobs that confer dignity on every member of the society. The reason I don't want to give up on that project is that the dignity of work is partly about purchasing power. It's partly about making a living, but it's also about contributing to the common good and winning recognition or appreciation or respect for having done so, for being a contributing member of society. And I think people sense that they are contributing in ways that others value and appreciate is an important part of what holds societies together. So this is why I would not want a universal basic income to replace or remove pressure for the society to see to it that everyone has access to a job at dignified pay that can provide them social recognition and esteem. That's the reason for my ambivalence. What are your thoughts about that? Do you find that persuasive? How do you view it?
Yeah, I would agree with you. I think people do get value for themselves. They get self-esteem out of a perception that they are also contributing to social good. And a lot of that would come from the job they do and from the work they do in the community and so on. So I think it's certainly desirable that people have something meaningful to do. So I would broadly agree with you on that.
If I could just ask briefly, because sure. I'm interested, what are the prospects for a universal basic income in India?
Not too good. I mean, we don't really have the kind of social welfare system in place which could perhaps even be replaced by a basic income. I mean, even if funding were to be shifted. What we do have is a kind of guarantee of employment for 100 days a year to people who are below a certain income level. But that is quite closely tied with public works and rural development activities and so on. But I don't think our budget as of today would probably allow us to contemplate a universal basic income.
Yeah.
If you don't mind, I have a final question for you.
Please.
Again, towards the end of your book, you're quite critical of what you call the financialization of the economy. And, many of our MBA students who are on this call, they would be looking at jobs in the finance sector as something they aspire to. So, are they doing the wrong thing? Sort of elaborate a little bit on your view on this and what, according to you, what's the right kind of work people should be doing?
Right. Well, you're really putting me on the spot in front of these MBA students headed to finance, some of them. I distinguish in the book between two different kinds of work within finance. And I begin by observing that in recent decades, finance has come to play a greater and greater role in the economy, whether as measured as a share of GDP, and especially if one measures as a share of corporate profits. Finance looms larger and larger, especially in rich countries. And the question is this a good thing? Is this something to welcome or not? And I think by and large, it's a troubling thing, the financialization of the economy that we've seen in recent years for the following reason. Finance is important to any economy, provided it performs the traditional social function of finance, which is to allocate capital to socially useful, productive purposes, creating new businesses, new factories, homes, schools, roads, hospitals, infrastructure. Provided finance directs capital to socially useful activities like these, the economy becomes more productive. And so finance is very important for these purposes, for development, for productivity, increasing the productive capacity of the economy. But much of the growth, indeed most of the growth, in the financialization of the economy in recent decades in rich countries has not been of this productive kind. It has instead been the development of ever more sophisticated financial engineering and speculation that does not actually direct any capital to new productive activities, but consists instead in speculative bets on already existing assets, many of them synthetic assets and derivatives, credit default swaps, that kind of thing, that don't actually reach the real economy. And despite that fact, this speculative and often extractive aspect of finance pays very well. So when I'm in writing about merit and meritocracy, I'm suggesting that this system of rewarding speculative finance very lavishly, more so than work that contributes to the real economy, whether in finance or in business, I think that is out of alignment with the true value, social value of the contribution. And so I would distinguish, to go back to your question, Professor Krishnan, between those aspects of the financial industry that do support the real economy and increase its productivity, and those aspects of the financial industry that don't, that consist mainly of bets upon bets, a kind of speculative activity quite far removed from investing in the productive aspects of the economy. Do you think that's too harsh, or do you see the force of that?
Yeah, I'm inclined to agree with you, but I think it's a little bit out of step with what the broader finance and business world thinks. But
maybe. Well, I think it's out of step with what the financial industry thinks. I'm not so sure it's out of step with what business leaders think, those who are actually engaged in investing in productive activity. I think many business leaders who are in the real economy and who are concerned with investment in new plant and facilities and factories and businesses, I think that many are quite skeptical of the purely speculative aspect of finance, which doesn't help them.
So, Sriram, back to you.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Rishi. We can have the students on because they've been waiting. So, Natasha, can you take over and coordinate the student bit? Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sandel, for taking out the time to address us today. We truly are honored and it's a privilege to have you here with us. I will now invite the student panel to raise their hand for questions, and then I can invite them. to post their question to you. Jyotish, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Thank you for the opportunity. So Professor Sandel, my question to you is with regards to the inequalities in countries. So in most countries, you know, there are always some parts of the country which are net contributors economically and others are net extractors. And this leads to resentment on both sides, as you see in the Catalan independence movement or in the American coast versus heartland discourse, or here in India, it's usually like the southern states versus the Hindi belt. So the Rawls-style redistribution of wealth that you have mentioned in your book between states becomes a very tricky meritocratic question on whether the poorer states deserve the richer states' largesse. Like, have they made the correct policy decisions? Have they educated the citizens? And therefore, are they just wasting that money? So how to resolve such a problem politically in a federated system?
Well, it's an important question, Yutesh, and thank you for that. Because as you say, this question arises and creates regional tensions, especially in federal systems around the world. I think the only way to deal with this challenge, this is not just an economic challenge. And I think it may be a mistake to conceive it as a question about how to deal with the unequal merit of different regions. Poor states in a federal system are not necessarily wealth extractors, even if they receive through the redistributive mechanism of the country more revenues than they contribute. If we view poor states in a federal system simply as wealth extractors, as lacking the merit of rich states, then I think there is bound to be the kind of tension you describe. But the reason the answer requires going beyond economics is that it raises the question of political community. What is political association for? And now one of the purposes, this goes back to Aristotle, one of the purposes of political association is to engage in economic relations, to buy and sell goods together and to consume goods. But that's only part of the purpose of a country or of a political association. The broader, larger purpose is to create together a common life, often a common life that draws on shared history and traditions, even though the history and the traditions may include elements of conflict and disagreement. So if a political community or a country aspires to be a community that cultivates a common life and aspires to certain shared purposes, whatever the differences of language and history and culture and tradition, then it's important not simply to view poor states as wealth extractors or because of their poverty as lacking in merit, but it's important to figure out how to include and develop and strengthen those places, which will require sharing the resources of rich states. So do you see what I'm suggesting? If we think only, if we think political association or a federated country only as in economic terms, where poor states are seen as lacking merit and rich states are seen as meritorious, then the political project becomes hopeless. Then there is not really the sense of community and of shared belonging and of common purpose that shared identities and political communities require. So that's how I would approach this very difficult question. And countries that have these imbalances have to decide, Do we want to try to develop the poor areas so that they can join the prosperity of the wider society? That's a fundamental question that goes beyond economics. It's a moral and political and cultural question.
All right, thanks for the answer, Professor Sandel. That was very illuminating.
Thanks.
Thank you, Professor. Yash, can you please unmute yourself and ask your question?
Thank you, Professor Sandel, for the wonderful and persuasive answers that you have been giving. I have two small questions. One, primarily for the Indian context. One way to deal with this tyranny of merit is what Indian government has done is expand the educational infrastructure. Do you think that is a feasible solution? Because we have created a lot more IITs, a lot more IIMs, and a lot more what I may call as sand castles of meritocracy. That's one. Number two is something that caught my attention is, you said work is contributing to common good and winning recognition, which inherently drives me to the point that humans being have this inherent drive for competition as well as winning recognition. So meritocracy will some way manifest, or competition will some way manifest if we replace this system, the existing system that we intend to replace. How do you plan to replace this system, and can we come up with an alternative, more egalitarian model?
Well, thank you, Yash, for both of these questions. Expanding education is a good thing. It's always a good thing. And especially in societies that depend on developing through equipping more of its citizens with access to a top education. So I think that is one important response to the inequalities of our society. Even so, it's important also to develop forms of education that and forms of learning that equip people for the world of work and of contribution who may not be able to attend university or an IIM. But expanding education generally, that's worth doing for a society for its own sake. The question you ask about competition and recognition, and whether there might be a tension between these two impulses. We have certain competitive impulses, and we want recognition, all of us, for the contributions we make. And how to reconcile these two impulses? Yash, it's not easy. And when I write about the dignity of work, you're right, I emphasize that work is not only a way of making a living, it's also a way of winning recognition and appreciation for the contribution one makes. And yet it's true, I think this is the thrust of your challenge. Some people are able to contribute more than others. And won't that lead, that competition and those differential contributions lead to some being recognized and some being looked down upon? I worry about this very much. And part of the tyranny of merit that I describe in the book is of radically unequal recognition. And a sense among many working people that in recent decades, the society doesn't value or appreciate the work they do if they're not well credentialed, if they haven't been to university, if they're not part of the professional classes. So I think struggles over recognition are right at the heart of contemporary political, the political tension and even resentment felt by many people today. So how to deal with it? Here's one way, Yash. I think there are two different notions of dignity and respect. Every society needs to take account of. Everyone, as a human being, is worthy of respect as a person, as a fellow human being. This is Kantian dignity, respect for persons as persons, quite apart from contribution or skills or talents. So every society needs to provide fundamental respect for the dignity of persons. But in addition to that, the dignity that I speak of when I write about the dignity of work and the need for recognition, that's something further. That's the dignity that comes when I am able to contribute in one way or another to the common good, and when the society acknowledges and recognizes my contribution. This is what I mean by the dignity of work. And by the way, it need not only be paid work, and I may not emphasize that enough in the book, because there are many contributions to the common good that are not part of the paid labor market, including raising children, for example. But the recognition that comes from the society and that answers and acknowledges contribution, this is above and beyond respect for persons as persons. And at its best, this kind of social recognition is essential to citizenship, to a shared civic life, to a sense of belonging, to a sense of membership. Contribution is bound up with membership, and so is recognition. So I'm suggesting that respecting persons as persons, that's a fundamental, universal, Kantian mode of respect. But it's not enough to hold a society together. That's my suggestion. That we also need, if we care about building a sense of community and solidarity, this other form of recognition which responds to and elicits contributions to the common good. Do you think that distinction makes sense, Yash?
That makes sense, Professor. Thank you.
Thanks.
You make a compelling argument, Professor. I just have one follow-up question to that.
Yeah.
Marx's theory speaks of an economic base and a sociocultural superstructure. And the argument is that the sociocultural superstructures sort of drive the economic advantage and the privilege of the capitalist or the aristocrat. And the aristocrat in turn supports the entire narrative that privileges it. So can we extend the argument to say that the aristocrat of yesterday is the intellectual of today, which is supporting the entire meritocracy argument that privileges it?
Well, Natasha, thank you for that. I would say, I see what you mean by the suggestion that the intellectual of today or the well-credentialed professional of today, speaking more broadly, is the aristocracy of the old regime or of a caste society. And I think there's a lot of truth in this. In many ways, meritocracy was seen as a liberating alternative to aristocratic and caste privilege. Everyone could compete on his or her own, regardless of the accident of birth. So it seemed liberating. And yet, it's clear that today, the affluent, credentialed, professional classes have become pretty good at figuring out how to pass their privileges onto their children, onto the next generation, so that it becomes self-perpetuating, even though we do have success stories of the kind that Sriram and I were discussing, where we find inspiring stories of those who come from poor backgrounds or from lower class who succeed, who rise. Even so, the meritocracy of today has hardened into a kind of aristocracy. So I agree with your suggestion, Natasha. I wouldn't say that this illustrates the truth of Marx's distinction between economic base and social cultural superstructure for the following reason. I think that we should not draw too sharp a distinction between the economy on the one hand and culture on the other. Because what counts is the economy, and what relations, our economic relations, are shaped powerfully by the way we interpret and understand them. And these interpretations are a matter of culture. So the economy shapes the culture, but cultural understandings also shape and sometimes reconstitute the economy, which is why earlier I was emphasizing the attitudes toward success, toward winning and losing, that have accompanied the rising inequality, and in some ways made it more difficult to bear for those left behind, the attitude of winners and losers. So with that qualification about the way to understand the relation between economy and culture, I would say, and I am suggesting in the book, that today's meritocracy has begun to harden into a kind of aristocracy or privilege of the credentialed professional classes. Natasha.
Thank you, Professor. Prathamesh, could you please go ahead and ask your question?
Sure, thank you. Thank you, Professor Sandel, for taking out the time. My question is in line with what you spoke about sports personnel earlier. For the most disadvantaged communities in India, Professor, education is not just a tool towards empowered lives, but it's also a poverty elevation program. At least that's the perception. But in the book, we see that only the most well-off students manage to get admissions into the best of colleges. Globally, do you think that the quality of education bridges the economic divide or extends it further?
Today, at least in the societies with which I'm most familiar, higher education is less a vehicle for upward mobility than a reinforcing institution, replicating existing patterns of privilege. There are exceptions, of course. And I think that institutions of higher education that make deliberate efforts to recruit students from poor backgrounds or from families that did not themselves attend higher education, I think this is an admirable and necessary way of broadening access to higher education. So I'm very much in favor of those efforts. But on the whole, in practice, there is a vast disproportion of students from well-off backgrounds at the best universities, by comparison with students who come from poor backgrounds. I mentioned in the book the fact that in the American highly selective Ivy League universities, there are more students from the top 1% of families than there are from the entire bottom half of the country. So this would be one quite stark measure of the fact that there is a class pattern, a kind of reinforcing tendency of higher education. And I think this is an illustration of the way meritocracy, instead of being the liberating project that many of us hoped and expect, has come to reinforce privilege rather than be an engine of upward mobility. There are also some interesting studies done by an economist named Raj Chetty and a team of economists in the US that look at how many students at various colleges and universities actually do come from poor families and wind up rising to the top 20% in income. And looking at American colleges and universities, public and private, elite and non-competitive, looking at some, I think 1,800 such universities, Chetty and his team found that the percentage of students who entered from the bottom, from poor families, and rose was about 2%. And that's not because higher education doesn't help lift people up. It's because so many of the students come from middle-class or upper-class families in the first place. And so in the book, I describe it this way, that higher education is like an elevator that most people enter. Higher education is like an elevator in a building that most people enter on the top floor. That's why it's not the engine of upward mobility we sometimes believe it to be.
Sure, Professor. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor, for that very interesting analogy. Rishabh, would you like to go next?
Good morning, Professor. Sir, I wanted to ask, in the book, you talk about the evils of meritocracy even after one is admitted to an educational institute. You talk about the low acceptance rate of student organizations, and one could argue like awards based upon academic or extracurricular excellence and job fairs. So, sir, what role do you see us as students and teachers to eliminate this, as you say, the reenactment of trauma and rush of meritocratic competition? What do you think we can do?
Well, Rishabh, let me first ask you a question. Do you find that description applies in your experience in India?
Yes, sir. Because while as you talk in the book, sir, we at least here we can see that great obsessiveness, like you have to compete and you have to like target the competitions, comfort in certain things for maybe a CV point which will help you in your final job fair. So yes, sir, I can relate to it personally, sir.
All right, I have one other question for you and yes, for the other participants. One of my favorite movies is The Three Idiots. Have you seen The Three Idiots?
Yes, sir.
That movie?
Sure. Yes, sir.
Do you like it?
Yes, sir.
Well, one of the reasons I love it is The Three Idiots raises in a funny but poignant way.
So, Michael, it was shot in...
Sorry?
It was shot in our campus.
It was shot in your campus?
Yes.
I love the movie. And it's the movie, in a way, the movie is an illustration of the central themes of my book, The Tyranny of Merit, though the movie existed before the book did. Because what it shows is not only, and I see this in my students as well, not only is there intense competition for admission to these highly competitive places, leading to tremendous pressure on young people, which pressure to achieve that can be damaging in many ways. But even once students are admitted to IIMs, like the one in Bangalore or to the Harvard campus, there is, as Rishabh was saying, there is a replication of this same meritocratic tournament. And my worry, apart from the emotional toll that it exacts on the students themselves, which is considerable, and in The Three Idiots, we saw examples of this, but beyond even the mental health effects and the emotional effects, I worry that the sorting function of higher education, the credentializing function, the networking function, is beginning to crowd out the intrinsic love of learning. Now, this may be less of an issue in professional schools, which are explicitly about preparing people to enter various professions, business, for example, or engineering, but from the standpoint of liberal arts education, learning about philosophy and about history and about the literature and about the classics and reflecting on one's passions and what makes life worth living and what studies to pursue, the intrinsic love of teaching and learning is difficult to sustain when higher education becomes centrally concerned with being a sorting machine. And I fear that we are approaching that condition where the sorting, credentializing, networking aspects of higher education are beginning to crowd out the intrinsic educational mission of teaching and learning.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. So can we as students or teachers can do something in the short run to maybe try to dampen its effects at least, or maybe not completely eliminate it?
Well, you tell me, what do you have some thoughts about that?
So I'm really not sure. It feels like a rat race. I'm not really sure how to remove the rats from the race or to eliminate the race altogether. I'm not sure.
To remove the rats from the race or to change the race. Natasha, can we just open to all of the students here for any thoughts about whether they see this as a problem? And if so, whether people have thoughts about measures that students or the institutions themselves could take to ease the intensity of the pressure and of this kind. Could we just for a moment see if people would like to address that? I'd be interested to hear what people have to say about that.
So personally, I'd just chime in that when you said 3 days, it brought a smile to all of our faces. And that's not just because it was shot on our campus, but as students, we relate to it so personally. So I think the truth definitely holds. Although posed very satirically in the movie, it's a very, it's a persistent reality, but would definitely like to know what the others think about it.
Does Varsha have a thought about it?
Hi, Professor. The one thing I always felt is it's not just the students who are obsessed with grades or awards, whatever the institutions offer, but indeed they are maybe put into that position because of the, you know, the pressure around them put forward by the college or the recruiters itself. These are the criteria which are looked by the recruiters to give them a job opportunity. So maybe students are put into that situation rather than them chasing it. That's what.
Okay, then how would we change the structure of recruitment or of universities? This is the hard question. To alleviate to some degree those pressures. Do you have thoughts about that, Varsha?
Professor, I really understand why the merit is taken. Maybe it's one of the easiest methods to segregate students. And your books goes into deep how to, you know, like handle it. Actually, I don't know how we can replace the system, but I really understand the injustice in it.
Yeah, that's so interesting. Yashika?
Yeah, drawing from 3 Idiots, we can say much of the pressure that a person faces is because the person is doing something that the person is not really wanting to do. If passion is the true guiding force, irrespective of whatever be the circumstances, the person will not be affected by it. So that is one way. If as an institution, we look for passion in the students, and the passion is the guiding force for the students in deciding what they want to do and not a particular target job or a dream company that they have in mind, I think a lot of pressure can be eased in that way.
Thank you for that. Anyone else with thoughts along these lines?
To be honest, sir, I totally agreed with what you suggested in the book. Just throw it all down the ladder and pick up the top, whatever. Because definitely merit as a threshold. Anybody who's made it thus far has practically all the necessary qualifications to do well in any of the jobs. So the necessity that recruiters have to think that, oh, you know, for this particular job, I have a lot of applicants and therefore I need to somehow winnow them on the basis of whatever. That's essentially the problem that, you know, we need. So the part of dignity of labor, that all of the jobs are equally valuable as long as it's what you are passionate about, instead of being, oh, you know, for example, in our institute, it's like, right now, jobs that are in the financial sector or in consulting companies, those are the most sought after. And whether it does not really matter whether or not you're interested in those areas, there's a added privilege of landing one of those jobs, which is totally unrelated with your interest in the field.
And do some people who go on to those jobs find after a year or two that it's not for them?
In fact, that's for most people. Most people kind of switch out of these jobs within 2 years. Hmm.
Interesting. Who else? Before we leave, I'm fascinated by people's thoughts on this topic, though I know there are other questions. Are there one or two more thoughts about this? Guntra?
Sir, so while I do agree with you on the injustice of merit, however, just to sort of play the devil's advocate here, the alternate that you had suggested, that of the division of excess rewards amongst others, I do not really completely agree with that. I believe that the idea of merit and the rewards associated with it sort of drive the economy towards progress. And without the promise of those rewards, people do not really have the drive to really work hard. So what are your thoughts on that?
I find it interesting, and it's an argument that is often made, Guntra. Do you think, now we're talking about take jobs in with consulting companies, management consultant, and finance, just as examples of well-paying jobs that many people compete for intensely. Do you think that if those jobs paid less, that not enough talented young people would want to go into them?
It's not just about pay, I believe. It's also about the brand or the reputation or the just the respect that you may get from those jobs. So by rewards or by payoffs, we may not necessarily just talk about income, right?
Right. There's the prestige associated with these jobs. And do you think society would be less productive if the most talented students, if fewer of the talented students went into management consulting and finance?
Sorry, sir, I don't think I would be able to comment on that.
Okay, all right, fair enough. So who's not yet had an opportunity? Natasha, do you want to resume calling on those who haven't yet had?
I was going to suggest that Arjun has had his hand up for a while. So maybe
this
question.
Please.
So thank you, Professor. First of all, I'm a fan of your Justice lecture series. I had this question about affirmative action here. So the Indian affirmative action is primarily a form of compensatory affirmative action. And since it is active since decades, it so happens that one family could be benefiting from it for multiple generations. So how should we argue when it is the right time for a family to stop getting the benefits?
For a specific family, do you mean? Or for the policy as a whole, Arjun?
Yes, for a specific family. A lineage for that matter.
Right, and by lineage you mean giving an advantage to the children of parents who had attended the university in the past.
Yes, sir, right.
Well, I think there are two issues here. What you're calling lineage, or what we call legacy admissions, is when universities give an advantage to the children of alumni of the university. And the way legacy admissions works in the US is it tends to give an advantage to applicants, students from well-off backgrounds, because their parents and maybe their grandparents have attended before them. So this is a kind of affirmative action, or reservations, to use the Indian term, for the privileged. Now, so I would I would reduce or eliminate legacy admissions. Affirmative action or reservations generally has a different purpose, not to give an advantage to a lineage or legacy within a family, but to give special consideration to applicants who come from either poor backgrounds or from racial, ethnic, and caste backgrounds that are underrepresented in higher education. And this kind of admissions policy, I'm sympathetic toward that, because it can be a way of either compensating for a history of injustice. It can also be a way of taking into account the fact that the scores from students from poor backgrounds may not be quite as high as the scores of a student, say, from a rich family, but it may suggest, given the educational opportunities the poor student has, greater potential. So there's the argument of compensating for past injustice, and there's the argument for taking into account what a test score really means from a rich student and a poor student in terms of their potential. For both of these reasons, I think there is an important place in admissions for affirmative action or reservations, whether in the name of justice or whether in the name of making a more accurate prediction about the potential of students who come from less privileged backgrounds. Arjun.
Michael, we're running out of time. Would you give 15 minutes more, or we have to move?
Sure. Yeah, there's still some hands up. People have been waiting. Go ahead.
Natasha, you can go ahead.
Anirudh, would you like to go next?
Yeah, sure. Professor Sandel, my question is regarding the proposal on using a lottery as the secondary filter beyond a certain merit threshold, which we just discussed a short while ago. What I'd like to ask you is, do you have any thoughts on whether the same can and should be extended to career progression at the workplace, let's say in large corporations or in government bureaucracies, where a large pool of almost equally talented employees with 15 to 20 years of experience or even more would be competing for a limited number of senior management or leadership positions? Would the implications be different from what you argue for college admissions, or can the same reasoning be extended to the workplace as well for extremely seasoned professionals?
Well, thank you, Anirudh, for that question. It would depend, I think, on how confident the business or organization is that it can make very detailed, fine-grained predictions about who really will be most qualified to hold, say, a senior management position in business or a high position, say, in the civil service. In the case of university admissions, one of the reasons I propose a lottery of the qualified, and by lottery of the qualified, I mean taking out of consideration those who could not do the work and do it well, who could not benefit and contribute, but then still there are a great many left who could. And Sriram is just giving me the estimate before that of the 200,000 applicants to IIM Bangalore, more than 5,000 are well qualified and could flourish at the institution. So I say, let's do a lottery among those, in part because I am very skeptical that it is possible for an admissions committee, even a seasoned admissions committee, to make accurate predictions of 18 or 19 or 20 year olds about who really will be the most outstanding economists or business people or government leaders based on their record and their test scores exam scores at age 18 or 19 or 20. I really don't think that it's possible anyhow. So in the business setting, it would depend on whether these fine distinctions can be made with confidence after or in mid-career. Maybe it's easier in mid-career than it is at 18 or 19 years old. So that would be one factor. But the other reason for the lottery for admissions has to do with leaning against the tyranny of merit, reminding students of the role of luck in admission, reminding the winners of the luck, those who are admitted, but also reminding those who do not win admission that there's a lot of luck and contingency involved in who gets in. And so you should not consider it an adverse judgment about your merit, your worth, your virtue. And this could be a factor in government and business settings, though perhaps less so. So it would depend on those two considerations. What do you think? Could I just quickly ask you what you think about extending about the lottery idea in higher education or in government and business?
So the reason for my question is, especially in India, if we take the example of the civil services, we have, even there, even after a civil servant serves in the bureaucracy for 10 to 15 years, the number of applicants or the number of candidates is still sufficiently large that similar dynamics come into play. And let's say an organization in a public sector undertaking would probably have thousands of people across the country in a mid management level. And although the scale is definitely not as high as 200,000 as it is for college admissions, it's still in the large hundreds or thousands that argument for a lottery could probably be made, which is why I was wondering whether it makes sense or not.
Yeah. Thank you. And what would be your answer to that question? Yes or no?
I would lean towards yes. That's just my personal opinion, because if a candidate has been successful enough to make it to that stage in the organization that far, that probably means that they do have the relevant experience and capacity to progress. And unless there are very strong reasons to not consider a candidate, and if there are any adverse incidents in their professional record, then I think almost all of them could probably be considered on an almost equal footing.
Right. Thank you for that.
Thank you, Professor.
Do we have time for one more, Sriram, Natasha?
Professor, if you have the time.
Yeah. So.
Michael, we'll take Yeshika and we'll take a couple of audience questions which have come in.
Okay.
Thank you, Professor. Yeshika, do you want to go ahead?
Yeah, thanks, Natasha. Sir, in the book you discuss about merit and job versus despair due to excess responsibility. From an individual side, you excellently explain how an individual can deal with attribution bias by having faith in the larger logic of universe being designed for entire cosmos and accepting the grandeur and the mystery of creation. Then you mention about a perfectly open society and talk about rethinking how we conceive success by questioning the meritocratic conceit of those that have made claim to have made on their own. So here I have two questions. First is, when in job, the person will have access to resources. So why should recruiters spend their resources in segregating merit attributable to merely effort and talent? I would like to understand what would be the motivation for recruiters to account for tyranny of merit and beat efficiency and fairness perspective. And the second question is, let's say even if they decide to do it, how can they do it in a time and cost effective manner?
So what you're suggesting for recruiters would be to do what? You mean to hire without I didn't understand what proposal you were asking me about with regard to the recruiters.
So basically, we are mentioning that the recruiters look for merit, particularly because of efficiency gains, efficiency, and second is to ensure that there is fairness in the system. Now, the point is, the entire, we are talking about tyranny of merit, one reason of it being inequality in the access of resources, leading to difference in merit between two people. So,
yes.
My question is, once a person is selected in a particular job, the person will have access to resources. So why should a recruiter bifurcate between the person made that achievement because of having access to resources or because of on his own merit and talent?
If I understand, Yashika, the question correctly, I think you're suggesting that recruiters should not use measures of merit that reflect previous advantage, because do I understand that correctly? That many measures of merit that we use, including university entrance exams, but also measures of merit that recruiters use, may reflect the lack of resources or the access to resources in the past, but the companies will provide resources for whomever they hire to enable them to flourish. So shouldn't they take this into account? Do I have you right?
Yes, sir.
And I would agree. I agree that many measures of merit that recruiters may use may simply reflect access to resources that the privileged have had. But once they're hired, the companies will provide resources. And so they should not use metrics of merit that essentially reflect the fact that some young people have had access to greater resources in the past and therefore are able to demonstrate their merit more fully than young people who come from less privileged backgrounds, but who, given the resources, will be able to flourish and to contribute. So I agree with you, but what I take from that is that we need to be very careful about the metrics of merit, the way we measure merit in admitting students or in hiring students, recruiting students for jobs, because metrics can be misleading insofar as they simply reflect that some have more privileged backgrounds than others. Thank you for that.
Sir, again, a follow-up question on this. So if there in a particular company, there would be a limited requirement of number of people, and choosing people, since these metrics that we use for merit are easily available, as a recruiter, for me, it becomes an easier task to pick up a few handful of people for which a ready-made proof is already available. Then from the entire talent pool, identifying people who have the talent and who will put in efforts and do well when given the resources, because that would be something which is costlier for me.
But incurring those costs to get a truer estimate of who really can contribute and flourish, despite coming from a poor background, will make for a better society, make for a better business too. It may be a way of getting at who really can contribute most, even though they come from a background that lack resources. But more than that, being attentive to the social and economic background of applicants can be a way of bringing about a society that is less divided than our societies are by these differences of income and wealth and privilege. That's valuable for its own sake, as well as possibly being valuable to companies and to the workplace.
Thank you so much, Professor, for being kind enough for taking all our questions. I will now invite Professor Sriram to take over and present the audience questions. Thank you.
Thank you. There are a couple of questions, Michael, if you don't mind, since the large number of them have come in, but I'll just read out a couple. One is from Professor Prasad, who used to be a colleague. He says he's as a student of organizational politics and observer of ongoing struggle for autonomy, security, and prestige. He's asking, would you have got flak for being politically incorrect, or have you got flak for being politically incorrect? And what would have happened had you titled your book The Triumph of Merit or The Tyranny of Incompetent Meritocracy, Mediocrity?
Well, I don't know whether I've been attacked for being politically incorrect, Professor Prasad, but I can say that the book has been provocative, and many people have registered disagreement, I think, because meritocracy is by now an article of faith, especially in mainstream circles, especially in well-educated, credentialed professional settings. And it's easy to see why. If meritocracy is just, if it's true that the successful deserve their place, their success, if our success is the measure of our merit, then any suggestion to the contrary is liable to, I think, generate resistance. And I have encountered some of this resistance. Not only, I don't want to suggest that it's only out of a sense of self-interest, people defending their place. Much of it is also principled, because the principle of merit, of rewarding people based on merit, does seem a liberating alternative to nepotism, privileges of class and race and class, hiring people just on their merits, whatever their background. That seems, in many ways, has been the kind of liberating political project as it's presented itself of recent decades. So people are attached to it. And I'm suggesting it actually has a dark side that we haven't fully recognized. And the dark side is that it is creating societies of winners and losers. And that this is damaging to, this is corrosive of the common good. It undermines solidarity in a sense that we are all in this together. And it's generating a sense of exclusion, anger and resentment among those left behind by the market-driven globalization of recent decades, who are increasingly turning against elites toward authoritarian populist figures who speak to their grievance, who speak to their anger against elites, who speak to the sense that elites are looking down on them. So part of my argument with friends and colleagues who defend the meritocratic ideal I'm questioning is, look at the kind of politics it's produced. Look at the anger and resentment among many working people that have led them, many, to embrace authoritarian populist regimes and figures and parties. And if you are worried, this is my argument to many of my colleagues, if you are worried, take the example of Trump in the United States. I won't mention other populist figures who also draw on anger and resentment of elites. You can draw your own conclusions. But if you're worried about these developments globally, in countries around, democracies around the world, it's worth looking to ourselves and worth looking toward the political project we've offered that may have contributed to the sense among many working people that elites look down on them. And maybe this explains the appeal of the authoritarian populace we're seeing today. So that's how I've tried to respond to my critics, including the principled critics.
I'll just slip in one last question because we have received a lot, but at least one more, and then I'll request Professor Rishi to thank you. This is from Santosh, from a fellow Indian Institute of Management in Ahmedabad. He's a doctoral student. Says, in India, caste elites have reproduced their hegemony across institutions. The political accountability channel has been ineffective in promoting equality and equity, particularly the most post-liberalization, neoliberal, market-driven phase. So he's asking, what solutions do you propose to make our institutions more effective in achieving equitable outcomes?
Well, this really is what the book is about. And what I suggest in broad terms, I don't have a detailed list of policy proposals. My goal is to reframe the terms of public discourse, to move away from responding to inequality, the widening inequalities of our time, simply or mainly by telling people, if you want to compete and win in the global economy, get a university degree, because what you earn will depend on what you learn. You can make it if you try, just strive harder. Because there is an insult implicit in that seemingly inspiring message. The implicit insult is this: if you're struggling in the new economy, and if you didn't go to university, your failure must be your fault. That's the implication. The inadvertent message of the rhetoric of rising, as I describe it, that has predominated among center-right and center-left mainstream political parties. And so I don't have a detailed policy solution, but what I suggest in the book is that we shift our public discourse, our political project, from focusing only or mainly on offering individual upward mobility through higher education as a solution to inequality, and deal with inequality more directly as a structural problem, to reconfigure our economies in ways that renew the dignity of work, that ask how we can embrace policies not only that offer individual upward mobility to the relative few who can win admission to top universities, but how we can create an economy that provides jobs and dignity and the opportunity to contribute and to have a sense of recognition for contributing to everyone, whatever their credentials may be. So that's the shift in our way of thinking about aspiration. And it's an attempt to alleviate the harsh ethic of success that is pulling us apart, in hopes of finding our way to a more generous public ethic that opens us to a politics of the common good. That's the message of the book, Sri Ram.
Thank you very much, Michael. I think this conversation can go on for hours. It's been provocative. I mean, I still have some 15 questions left, but let me leave it there and hand it over to Rishi to thank you for having been with us. Rishi, over to you.
Thank you so much.
So, Professor Sandel, I must really appreciate your spending so much time with all of us. Your book itself was extremely thought-provoking. I enjoyed reading it, but our interaction with you today was even better because we got into more nuances, more details of your arguments. And I think we all benefited from it. I'd particularly like to thank all my student friends for, you know, not only reading your book very carefully, but also asking you some probing questions. And of course, to Sriram and the Center for Public Policy for setting this up. But all of this would not have been possible, of course, without your support and cooperation, Professor Sandel. And we really greatly appreciate your willingness and your, you know, acceptance of our invitation. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Rishi and Sriram, thank you so much. And to the students who really put these very, very demanding and probing, thoughtful questions to me. There's no greater reward that an author can get than to have such thoughtful responses and challenges to what I've tried to write in The Tyranny of Merit. And I very much look forward to future opportunities to continue the discussion. Thank you very much.